This is the Texas State Sports Network from Learfield, IMG College. HEB is proud to present Inside the Lines with Texas State head coach Jake Spavital. No store does more than my HEB.
We're going to win. We're going to win games. We're going to win championships. We're going to win bowl games.
Welcome once again to Inside the Lines. I'm your host, Brant Freeman. For the first time since September, the Bobcats are playing back-to-back weeks as they travel to Lafayette this Saturday to face the Louisiana Raging Cajuns. Before we look ahead to Lafayette, let's first go back to Jonesboro and a West Division showdown versus Arkansas State.
Texas State has the ball first, and it looks like the time off had a positive effect on running back Caleb Twyford.
Vet slaps his hands, hands it off. Twyford bounces outside. He may be gone. And midfield at the 40, one man to beat. 30, 20, 10. Russell down from behind at the 6-yard line.
Now, fourth and goal for the 1-yard line, and Coach Favital keeps the offense on the field. Look, you're not going to beat Arkansas State on the road with field goals. You need touchdowns, but the Bobcats won't get either. Tyler Vitt misfires for Hutch White, and Texas State turns it over on downs. The good news, though, is that the Red Wolves are backed up at their own 1-yard line. The bad news? Arkansas State embraces that challenge, driving the length of the field. Redshirt freshman quarterback Lane Hatcher, making just his fourth career start in place of the injured Logan Bonner, guides the Red Wolves all 99 yards at an 18-play drive, consuming more than 7 minutes off the clock. Hatcher caps off the drive with this 13-yard touchdown pass to Omar Bayless, who becomes the first player in the nation this season to top 1,000 yards receiving as A-State strikes first for a 7-0 lead. Later in the first quarter, Texas State backed up near its goal line, but it wouldn't be a long drive for the Bobcats. Instead, a fumble by Vitt after getting sacked, and the Red Wolves take over first and goal at the 2. That takes us to quarter number 2. Hatcher looking for Bayless again, but he's well covered by Jared Morris. Arkansas State has to settle for a field goal, which extends the lead to 10-0. After a 3-and-out by Texas State's offense, the Red Wolves have the ball back and again drive the ball deep into Bobcat territory. This time, A-State attacks with a ground game. Jamal Jones, a 7-yard run into the end zone. It is all Red Wolves at this point. Now 17-0 in favor of the hosts in Jonesboro. The Bobcats, though, are finally ready to respond. On the ensuing possession, Vitt takes a shot down the field and connects. Jeremiah Haydale on a 37-yard catch, and Texas State is in position to strike. But again, the Bobcats face with a fourth and short dilemma. And again, Coach Spavital elects to go for it. And this time, the gamble pays off.
Direct snap to Twyford around the right corner, looking for a block, diving for the far pylon. Did he get it? He did!
Next drive for the Red Wolves, and the Bobcats defense comes up with two huge back-to-back plays on back-to-back sacks. First is Nick Daniels, part of his 14-tackle night, and then it's Ishmael Davis. Those sacks lead to a punt, and the offense has the ball back, looking for back-to-back scoring drives. A great series of plays starts with a 39 screen play for Twyford, good for 18 yards at A-State territory. Next play, Vitt again with a strike to Haydale, 12 more yards for another first down. Next play, Vitt this time goes over the top, and watch the concentration of Jamaria Shereed.
Vitt back to pass, firing near side, has Shereed at the 10, grabbed from behind, dragged down inside the 5 to the 2-yard line.
Two plays after that, following a false start, Vitt doesn't miss Hutch White this time. A swing pass to the senior receiver is good for another touchdown, and just like that, it's a 3-point game, a score of 17-14 going into halftime. Early in the third quarter, and the Bobcats' hopes of carrying the momentum over from the first half into the second are dashed fairly quickly. A block punt by Omar Bayless sets up A-State to the 13-yard line, and it takes just one play for the Red Wolves to capitalize. Later in the third, and A-State makes another big play on special teams. B.J. Edmonds takes a punt back 34 yards as the Red Wolves open a drive inside the red zone for the third time of the game. And again, it leads to a one-play drive for Murray. And it's now 31-14 Arkansas State. Fourth quarter now, the Red Wolves looking to put the game away, and what better target than Bayless? His second touchdown of the night, good for his nation-leading 12th of the season, which caps off a big night for the Red Wolves as they snap a 2-game losing streak. The final score from Jonesboro, Arkansas State 38, Texas State 14.
A tough second half for the Bobcats as they were outscored 21-0 after halftime. But this Saturday, a chance at redemption as the Bobcats travel east to take on the Raging Cajuns in Lafayette. We'll talk more about that game and look back at the game against the Red Wolves coming up next with head coach Jake Spavital on Inside the Lines.
The 2019 Texas State football season is presented by HEB.
We, the people of Texas State University, united to create a more perfect future. We are the people who make this community a place we're proud to call home. Our ingenuity creates opportunities, turning great ideas into actions and actions into achievements. We are family, and together, we'll do more great things than you can imagine.
I'm Brett Ramsey. I've worked at HEB for over 40 years. Here, our team developed the Cody brand. These are coolers and tumblers that really stack up against other high-performance brands. They're as tough as Texas and perfect for all the things we love. And made with the highest quality at the best price, or we wouldn't put the HEB name on it. So enjoy keeping it cold without getting burned by the price. This is the Cody department at HEB. No store does more than my HEB.
When you're ready for a car that's kayak friendly, or you're just ready for a downsize, we approve. UFCU, with rates that challenge the big guys and people who understand your journey. We have auto loans for whatever life you want to live. Apply today at ufcu.org/myauto.
Hear that? That's 50,000 Texans. That's how many of us pick Texas Oncology every year. Every one of us has a story. A story just like mine. About being so much more than just a patient. So start your story with Texas Oncology and see why they're my team.
We're back at Inside the Lines as the Bobcats get ready to take on Louisiana this Saturday in Lafayette for a game against the Raging Cajuns, the Bobcats' second straight game on the road. We're now joined by head coach Jake Spavital, looking ahead of the game against the Cajuns, but first, coach, a look back at the game against Arkansas State from this past Saturday, a 38-14 defeat. I want to go back to early in that game for you. First drive of the game, third play of the game. Caleb Twyford rips off a 60-yard run, sets you up inside the 5-yard line. But you're unable to score and take advantage of that. Was that kind of a microcosm of the offense where you see what you're capable of for the big play but just couldn't quite finish?
Yeah, that was kind of how the whole game went. You know, we had a great warm-up. I had a great look in our eyes. The energy was great. You know, so I expect those kids to come out and to see Twyford hit that big run, you know, on the third play of the game, that was kind of refreshing for me. Like, these kids are coming to play right now. And unfortunately, we didn't get to punch the ball in. You're fourth and one on the 1-yard line. We got to find a way to get that. And we just didn't execute it. And to give Arkansas State credit, they do a 99-yard drive, 18 plays, and it was very methodical, and it was a really good drive. But you look at the entire first quarter, we were a little bit rusty. But, like, the thing about these kids, like, I asked them to fight and play with effort, and that's what they did, and they got us back in the game going into halftime, making it 17-14.
Exactly. Something your team does not lack this season is resiliency. To fall behind 17-0, make a game of it, 17-14 going into the break, you're right there. Third quarter, though, things get away from you. How did the game get away?
You know, like, you're going into halftime. There's a great look in that guy's eyes. Like, I think they're pretty fired up, very motivated to get out there. And I guess you could say it's like the snowball effect, or like Murphy's Law. Like, you know, we go out there, we tell the defense to get a stop, we get them to stop, they punt. And then next thing you know, we three and out, and then we get a punt blocked. And then it just kind of that whole third quarter with a great punt return on their end and also two interceptions, it puts the defense in a very bad spot. And, you know, the kids are playing with great effort. It's just we're not, you know, good enough to roll the ball out there and have those mistakes. When you have three turnovers and you have two special teams plays and the defense has put, you know, their backs against the wall three times where they're having to defend inside the 20, it just, it doesn't work out in your favor. And And that's kind of where we're at right now. I think the defense is playing at a high level. The special teams had, you know, their first game where they had some mistakes, and offense where we're continuing to struggle right now.
I want to highlight more the play of your defense. As you said, they continue to play at a very high level, and four sacks for your defense on Saturday, season high. Two of those came from Nick Daniels, also had 14 tackles, 3.5 of them tackles for loss. On a defense full of playmakers, how does Nick Daniels keep standing out?
We had this discussion today about Nick, about he's just got to be put in positions where he just goes and tackles the ball. You know, like, it's, you know, there's a lot of things in when it comes to linebacker play about playing pass, walling receivers, you know, disrupting their path, you know, kind of setting the edge in terms of spilling things back to, like, Brian London. But he's such a game, you know, just a game breaker guy that you just got to let him go and play. And there is a lot of great playmakers, but Nick Daniels is the one that's kind of separating himself right now.
Getting things back to the offense, this was the fourth time this season you've scored 14 points or fewer, and nobody wants to get things right more so than the people that come into this building each and every day, you, your staff, and this team. How do you go about turning around this offense?
Yeah, it's kind of the reality of where we're at. You know, you can't go out there and have 7-3 and outs and then have two interceptions with, you know, on the first play of the drive and on the second play of a drive. So you have 9 drives under 3 plays, and you're making the defense play at, you know, 37 minutes. You know, it's that was kind of the time of possession. So they're putting the defense in bad spots. But what we have to do is figure out what these kids are capable of doing. I know we have a lot of injuries right now. We're moving a lot of people around up front. We had a couple more receivers go down. We're playing with our backup quarterback right now, but that's not an excuse at all. Like, we got to have the next man up. We got to find what these kids are capable of doing. And it's the whole thing that we've talked about. This isn't a finger pointing culture. Mm-hmm. This is about lining up and the next man up and raising each other. Raising each other up and elevating their play, and that's what we've got to do on offense. And you know, I think the offensive staff is generating a game plan right now that might have a few different wrinkles and hopefully put these kids in better positions than what we've been putting them in.
Looking ahead of Saturday's game versus Louisiana, it is a Raging Cajuns team off to a good start. They're 5-2 so far this season. Also, a team coming off of a bye week as well. And you take a look at the offense in particular. Third best rushing offense in the country this season, and they got 3 backs doing it. Elijah Mitchell, Trey Regis, Raymond Calais. How do you go about preparing for that?
Yeah, the three-headed monster is what they've been named. It's a very tough challenge because I think Coach Napier does a really good job in creating matchups. It very multiple in the run game. You're going to see GT and counter and power and stretch and wide zone and inside zone and quarterback run. You're at toss cracks, all that stuff. You're going to see a lot of great run game and run schemes that are going to put those kids in good positions. And there's a reason why, you know, they're, you know, some of the nation's top leaders in rushing and scoring touchdowns is because they're also put in great positions. And that's going to be a very tough challenge. There's going to be a lot more linebacker body types. You know, we're going to end up using some of guys that are on their red shirt. We're going to have to use some of one of their games to play just based off of how heavy these guys get. And just due to the attrition of the season, we need some guys to step up their play. So it's going to be a very tough challenge, but I think our defense will be ready to respond to it.
Last week, we talked to you a lot about routine, how much it was affected in the month of October with 2 bye weeks and a midweek game thrown in between there. But now you go from one Saturday to the next, getting ready for a game. Does this feel more normal to you now?
It does. You know, you can put the previous game behind and keep moving on forward. And I think the kids are pretty excited just to get back into the swing of things and get back into a routine and kind of get comfortable with what they're doing. You know, there's a lot of thought that goes into the bye weeks and what you have to do and where you have to go and adding that into class schedules and everything. Now they know a routine and they're back into it. So we got 5 Saturdays in a row, and I think these kids are pretty fired up to do that.
All right, Coach, good luck this weekend in Lafayette.
I appreciate it.
And we'll take a further look into the Raging Cajuns coming up later in the show with Raging Cajun broadcaster Jay Walker. But up next, we go more in depth in the Bobcat secondary with assistant coach Brett Dewhurst. Back with more of Inside the Lines right after this.
Hey, Bobcat fans, for all things Texas State football, be sure to follow us online and through social media.
Jaren Morris, Jalen Smith, Cam Witters, and Deshaun Waddy, all good players in the Bobcats secondary who have made a number of big plays this season. And with good plays comes good coaching, and for the Bobcats, that comes from Brett Dewhurst.
Bouchel trying to receiver screen. Jay Morris on the interception, tackled at the 19-yard line.
No, they're improving week to week. I have some older guys there in the middle of the defense at nickel and safety and some young guys at corner. What we talk about all the time is just consistently improving. You know, each week you put something out there that coaches see, whether it's individually or schematically, and us as coaches too. And so talk about working on your strengths every week and then have a plan for your weaknesses, because other teams are going to attack it once you put it on tape.
I think Coach Dewhurst has already had a huge impact on the back end, you know, with the three kids that he signed with Cambrell Winters and Day Jordan Mask and Kevin Anderson. Those are three guys that are playing a lot as true freshmen. I think he is a guy that can recruit incredibly, but he's also one of the sounding boards for Zach up down there on the field, and he can actually handle these kids with just great passion, great energy, and they play extremely hard for him. Very efficient at what he does, and the relationship that he has with those kids, you can see that those kids will run through a wall for him.
Evans back to pass, firing downfield across the middle on the dike. Waddy on the interception at the Bobcat 43-yard line.
Well, we talk about it all the time. You know, as many possessions you can steal and get back to the offense is what we need to do. You know, and it's what you do with those turnovers. Same thing we talk about, and if you're put in a sudden change situation where if our offense turns the ball over or a bad situation on special teams, if we're getting a stop. You know, and so we always talk about working the football, and we do it in practice, and it just becomes a habit, you know, and then it's one of those things. We don't have a turnover chain, we don't have any of that stuff, we just expect to do it, and that's just kind of our identity and what it depends to be.
Flips it downfield, it's intercepted at the 35-yard line, then shoved out of bounds at the 39. Jalen Smith, his first interception as a Bobcat, the Bobcats' second pick of Bouchel tonight.
They play with a chip on their shoulder, and you know, as we look for recruiting, everyone wants those tall guys, but to me, it's if a guy's competitive and he's quick twitch and he's tough and plays with a chip on his shoulder, I'll take a 5'10 guy over a 6'2 guy that doesn't have that. A lot of these guys, the only way they learn is that they make the mistake themselves, you know, and so we try to, as soon as somebody else makes a mistake, point it out and learn from it and continue to get better.
The Inside the Lines Coaches Interview is presented by HEB. No store does more than my HEB. Play the HEB tailgate toss by texting HEB to 83200 for your chance to win groceries for a year.
We, the people of Texas State University, united to create a more perfect future. We are the people who make this community a place we're proud to call home. Our ingenuity creates opportunities, turning great ideas into actions and actions into achievements. We are family, and together, we'll do more great things than you can imagine.
My name is Mark, but around HEB, they call me the boss of the sauce. My job is to travel Texas, looking for the best salsas and sauces. After tasting lots of options, we want to try some new flavors. And that's how Mark's Good Stuff got started. These are unique products with delicious ingredients. They're inspired by Texas taste and everything I loved about growing up around here. Like this salsa, named for my old high school football number. This is the Taste of Texas department at HEB. No store does more than my HEB.
What started as a small group of about 20 student musicians 100 years ago is now known as the Pride of the Hill Country, the Texas State Marching Band.
Having this organization reach its 100th is just it's a remarkable milestone. The group started in 1919, started by a sophomore student, growing from a very small group of roughly 20 people, and now it's grown to a 330-piece marching band. We have three concert ensembles, the Wind Symphony, the Symphonic Winds, the concert band. We have the 90-piece basketball band. And the beauty of it is we encompass majors from all across campus. So we have engineering majors, we have business majors, we have nursing majors. So we're serving the entire university community, which is really fun.
We really value what we do on the field, but we also think that what we do in the stands is just as important to keep our fan base and our team kind of pumped up all throughout the game. So we try to make sure that if we can do anything to help our team, that's a positive thing, and anything to maybe distract the opposing team is also a good thing too.
Some of these people I met on the first day of band and other people I met in the School of Music, but we were in band together, and there's no experience that compares to being in the band. I mean, we rehearse 7.5 hours a week without game days, and then with game days, that's another 11 hours we spend together. But just spending so much time with each other, you develop those relationships. And something Dr. Glacier talks about a lot, he's probably said this 4 times this year, he always says, like, someone in this band is going to meet their future husband or wife.
We're very fortunate that we get very talented musicians from across Texas and outside the state of Texas. A big challenge for us is to make sure that we are able to teach them a new system about how we march here and how we play here and what we do. And thankfully, like I said, we have wonderful training that's happening in our public schools. But it's a big challenge for us to bring them up to speed quickly, and probably unlike their high school experience. We are learning multiple different halftime shows and a pregame show. So, you know, we will learn a total of 4 or 5 shows throughout the course of the year. In addition with all the music that we play in the stands, we are thankful for the level of talent that we have here. I think that allows us to have a lot of variety in our programming throughout the season.
Congratulations to the Texas State Marching Band on 100 years, and here's to 100 more. For Inside the Lines, I'm Sydney Tyndall.
Play UFCU, spin to win by texting UFCU to 83200 for your chance to win $1,000 in cash, Texas State gear, and other cool prizes.
Texans love Texas and its natural beauty. Now, there's a lot of land in Texas, but only a small amount, 4.7%, is protected natural space. Meanwhile, more Texans arrive every day. Our population is predicted to increase 52% over the next 30 years. So, how can we balance what's good for nature with what's good for all of us? Info from surveys, trailhead cameras, and drone footage reveals how people actually use parks, rivers, and protected places. Combined with geographic data like park size, location, and environment, patterns emerge. Geographer Jason Julian explains.
The San Marcos River provides a lot of benefits, and we want to use those, but we can protect the ecosystem by creating public access points so we can control and manage where the public's using them, and then protect sensitive areas.
This week's breakout performance of the game is presented by Texas Oncology.
Twyford bounces outside. He may be gone. In midfield at the 40, one man to beat. 30, 20, 10. Russell down from behind at the 6-yard line. And it's first down and goal, Bobcats.
Welcome back to Inside the Lines. The Bobcats are on the road again this weekend as they travel east at I-10 to take on Louisiana in Lafayette. We now welcome Raging Cajun's longtime broadcaster Jay Walker to talk to us more about Louisiana. And Jay, always a pleasure getting to visit with you. Let's talk about the Cajun season so far this season, a record of 5-2. This for a team that last year under Billy Napier, then in his first year as head coach, guided the team to 7 wins, a trip to the Sun Belt Conference Championship game, and a bowl game as well. What has made Coach Napier's brand of football so successful there in Lafayette?
I think it's been the attention to detail, Brent. You know, if you listen to Coach Napier speak and then you tune into an Alabama press conference, you're going to see how he's trying to mold this program. And he talks all the time about the process, not about the result. The results have been good. You know, the Cajuns probably should have beaten Mississippi State. They turned it over four times, and I think that there were a lot of folks who left there saying, okay, this is going to be a good football team, and at the same time, very disappointed that they didn't win the game. And, you know, I thought they had a fighting chance against Appalachian State, but to the Mountaineers' credit, they were able to make plays when they needed to. Other than that, the Cajuns have played some awfully good football, and I think the biggest improvement on this team has been on the defensive side of the ball.
Jay, let's now talk about the offense. Everybody in the Sun Belt Conference in awe about Louisiana's rushing game this season. Three backs all capable of rushing for 1,000 yards this season. You look at Louisiana's rushing game, it ranks third in the nation, number one in the country for teams that don't run a triple option-based offense. What has made the running game so good this season for Louisiana?
Well, I think what's impressive, Brand, is the fact that the Cajuns returned all five starters on the offensive line. But one of them was lost for the season before the season even started. And another one went down in game two. But Shane Vallow has done a great job stepping in at center. Freshman Osiris Torrance is playing the left guard and doing a good job. I was a little concerned when the offensive lineman got hurt, but the Cajuns really haven't missed a beat. Now, they've got three really good backs back there, and they all bring something different to the table. Trey Regis is very difficult to bring down on the first hit. Elijah Mitchell is probably the most versatile. He's got good speed, but he's also the Cajuns' best receiver out of the backfield. And Raymond Colley can just flat run. So all three have had their moments this year. And as a result, the Cajun running game has been very, very successful.
In addition to that great running game, you brought this up earlier, Louisiana also playing some very good defense this season. The Cajuns giving up just 20 points a game, second fewest in the Sun Belt Conference. So I look at this Cajun team, Jay, I'm not finding many flaws. Where do you see room for improvement for Louisiana as the Cajuns get set for the final five games of the season?
You know, I think the secondary is still a work in progress. Michael Jacquet has done a really, really good job at one corner. Eric Guerra is a little bit undersized at the other corner, but he's done a good job, too. The Cajun safeties, I think, is where the work in progress continues. But this is a deep defense, especially in the front seven. I have to give Ron Roberts, the defensive coordinator, a lot of credit. He's done a masterful job, in my opinion, of making in-game adjustments. I think Arkansas State was a great example. They scored on the very first drive of the game. And they only scored one touchdown the rest of the game, thanks to the adjustments they were able to make. So I'm impressed with the defense. And like I said earlier, I think that's the most improved part of this football game.
Looking at the matchup, Jay, this Saturday, Louisiana has had Texas State's number as the Bobcats have yet to beat the Cajuns since they joined the Sun Belt in 2013. Texas State is trying to end that skid this Saturday, but how does Louisiana ensure that doesn't happen?
I think, first of all, Texas State defensively can play with just about anybody in this league. You know, Brian London can play for me. I'm just telling you. You know, he's an all-conference guy. He's a very, very good football player. And I think Texas State's linebackers are all pretty good. You know, obviously their problem's been on the other side of the football. They've struggled with line play, and they're not going to have an easy time against the Cajun defense. But I don't expect the Cajun offense to have a walk in the park against this Texas State defense. We expect Texas State to come in and play for four quarters.
Thanks again to Jay Walker, and that's going to do it for this week's show. Tune in next week as we preview the Bobcats' return home with Texas State hosting South Alabama. Until then, for Inside the Lines, I'm Brian Freeman, reminding you to unleash your battle cry. We'll see you next time. This has been Inside the Lines with Texas State head coach Jake Spavital, presented by HEB. No store does more than my HEB. This is the Texas State Sports Network from Learfield IMG College.